fascinating gadgets, gizmos, and gear-based technologies. Welcome to Fascinating Gadgets, Gizmos, and Gear-Based Technologies. Now, this is the show that takes your favorite fictional science and technology, and we make it a reality. Who does that? We do. We are the Brain Trust. I am the analytical mastermind, Daniel J. Glenn. With me, the physics phenom, Dr. Michael Dennin.
Great to be here, Dan. I'm excited for this episode. It reminds me of, you know, why I wear my hat and also, you know, how much I love the Disneyland trains. So we'll just see where we go from there.
Well, I think it's a great start to get it. But, you know, we have, speaking of trains, we have an engineer with us, Dennin. I mean, this is great. We got one right on hand, right next to me, digitally speaking. And then as our enigmatic engineer, Ben Siepser. Ben, have you ever run a locomotive? And if so, are you broadcasting from said train as we speak?
Unfortunately, Dan, I've not run my own locomotive, but I have found myself in this amazing city that's entirely steam powered. I don't know how they've managed to engineer all of this, but I'm very excited to find out how this whole city ticks.
Well, I think that's going to be, well, we're going to do that as a group, Ben. So don't take that entire task on yourself.
Dan, I'm an overachiever sometimes, but I'll let you guys help.
Yeah, let us get involved here. I don't want you to, we don't need to overburden our engineer. It's already too crazy in the world of steampunk, which is what we're going to talk about today. Now, we came about this, guys, you know, we did our episode on The Matrix. We talked about cyberpunk. But today we're going to talk about steampunk, which is, you know, it's this interesting science fiction alternate history universe where steam is the ultimate power source. There's no electricity. Everything's mechanical. There's no internal combustion engine. And typically, this takes place in, you know, the Victorian era, England, or in the Wild West. And I got to tell you guys, when I think of steampunk, I think of the Wild West, although I'm pretty sure that it's mostly England that most of these stories take place. And I don't know what you guys have seen or thought or whatever, but that's what the impression I was under.
Well, that's where we're the opposite. I definitely thought it was a Victorian England thing, Dan. I don't know why. I think it's just, you know, the costumes in steampunk strike me as much more Victorian England than mm-hmm. Wild Wild West. But of course, you know, that does flash back to the movie that I shall not judge because, you know, I don't want to get a lawsuit against me of a similar name. So, sure. You know, maybe that's why the movie had trouble is it was not in the right physical location. I'm just going to, you know, suggest that perhaps, you know, should have been in England.
Well, now what about you, Ben? I mean, what do you think? Did you have any thoughts on where this should take place or were you just kind of new to the steampunk genre?
Yeah. You know, when I think of like the steampunk cosplay, I see it, you know, the conventions, it definitely is more, I don't know. I feel like it's kind of a mashup of the two. I feel like it's Wild West in a sense meets Victorian era. Mm-hmm. And, you know, maybe it's just, you know, it's a combination and, you know, the Victorian era gets the credit because it's fancier and people want to feel like they're, you know, Victorian nobles with their fancy, you know, steam engines rather than being, you know, dirty cowboys in the West.
And crusty prospectors and stuff.
Let's point out, Dan, we totally, you know, equate chimney sweeps with Victorian England and chimneys are connected to steam because you're burning coal. Right. I know it's a long shot, but that's the logical connection there.
I think you might be right. Well, it's funny because we just did an episode on The Nevers, which takes place in Victorian England, which you would think is steampunk. But as we decided, or at least as by we, I mean I, as the dictator in this group, I decided that it wasn't steampunk because we never see steam power. It's more Tesla punk because it's about free energy and batteries and stuff like that. But as you know, steam is key here. And the other thing is that this is extraordinarily analog technology. It's very gadgety, which, you know, I love that. And of course, I love it because it's the epitome of a gear-based society. And that is the namesake of our show, Gear-Based Technologies. Now, you guys may not know this, and I don't think anyone listening does. I don't think I've shared this with anyone out loud, only with myself. But the reason why the show is named Fascinating Gadgets, Gizmos, and Gear-Based Technologies is because of steampunk. Because I was watching some people dressed in you know, steampunk cosplay, and I was like, this is so cool. Like, the way they were able to take gears and mechanical stuff and turn it into really advanced technology. I loved it. I'm excited to do this episode, and I think we're going to come to some real solutions and possibly redefine the Wild West or England, depending on which one you really care about.
Well, and I'm really with you, Dan, on the gear thing. I mean, I think people really underestimate the power of the gear and what it did to transform what humans can do. You know, we electricity gets a lot of credit. It deserves a lot of credit. I get that. But just think about that moment in your life when you went from a single gear bike to a 3-speed or a 10-speed bike and how suddenly easier it became to go up a hill. Like, what greater moment in life is there than like, oh my gosh, I go slower, but I'm not working nearly as hard. This is cool.
Right. Well, this is a world for inventors just like Ben. I mean, I imagine you got to be a kid in a candy store here.
Yeah. Well, I like that Dennin brings up the gears because we, you know, we don't think about that, but they're kind of the hidden heroes of a lot of our mechanisms today. You know, you think about the gearbox in your car, the transmission in your car. Think of, you know, even internal combustion engines, they only really work well at in a relatively small band of revolutions, of speeds. And we need these gears to change the speed of the motor to match the speed of the wheels we actually want. And that invention and the perfection the ways we've perfected it over the past century or two have enabled all sorts of mechanical machinery that people 300-400 years ago could never have dreamed of.
I mean, I love that, you know, electricity gets all the headlines, but gears are the hidden heroes. I love that. That's an amazing quote.
I would really like, can you get me a mug perhaps? Maybe a mug that says gears are the hidden heroes? I'm just saying. I mean, I do like I am the physics phenom. It's a nice mug.
Right.
Some very handsome people are on the mug, but you know. But I really think I need a gears or the hidden heroes.
That is an ultimate analog technology there. I mean, that's how, if you want to live in an analog world, that's how you hold water, coffee, tea, whatever you'd like.
Yeah. Well, and the reason they have to be the hidden heroes is because of how powerful they are. Because gears are also super dangerous. And so you don't want to get caught in them. So we have to hide them. You know,
I think that's very true. Well, speaking of hiding, Ben, before you go too far off the rails here, speaking of hiding, I think a T-shirt might not be bad either. This one is this is biology's nature's technology. It's nothing to do with steampunk, but maybe electricity gets all the headlines. The gears are the hidden heroes. Maybe that's next on the list. But I'm not hiding from that fact anymore. I love it, Ben, and I'm glad you brought it to our attention.
Well, and Dan, you can't forget about hydration, which is what drives the steam engine.
Very true.
You can hide your water in a fabulous water bottle and make your own internal steam power.
You can. Well, and I think that's great because, you know, speaking of steam, we got to talk about steam. But first, I got a couple of things I want to talk about the Wild West. I'm a Wild West guy. Now, I'm more of a Weird West. I like the combination of supernatural and fantasy in the Wild West. You know, the advanced steam power wasn't necessarily, that's like third on the list, but I still love it. But it's the Wild West that I really like. And I'm so committed to this show and to the Wild West that I watched that movie you're talking about, Dennin. It's called Wild Wild West, which is, I think, the only major steampunk-themed or steampunk genre release, at least in the United States. And, you know, it won 8 Golden Raspberries, you know. so it wasn't the best, but it wasn't, you know, critically a hit. I think it's the biggest loss in a major motion picture since Waterworld. But I have to say, it has some redeeming qualities. I think it got a little bit of a bad rap. And I know, Ben, you love the mechanical spider at the end, which is the epitome of what you can do with steam power, gears, and a little bit of time and, you know, a dictator mentality.
That's right, Dan. I think you have to give the movie credit. While it wasn't a critical success, it was critically successful in displaying a ton of amazing gear-based technologies. That movie is chock full of awesome gadgets, some of which were steam-powered.
Yeah.
And what I like, it does show a scale here, Dan. If you notice, they didn't make small spiders. And that
was pretty big.
Right. And spoiler alert, you know, if you're going to make a gear-based steam-powered robot, you're going to probably make something large because you need a lot of space for your steam engine, your boiler, your heating source, your pressure. And so it kind of it works nicely together, right? Like the technology makes you go big. And if you're an evil dictator, you kind of want a big spider, not a small one.
that's very true. That is very true. Well, the one thing I want to say before we get, we got to talk about steam power here. I mean, it's the namesake of the genre. But before we do, I want to give a theme of what we're really going to do here, because what's cool about steampunk is it does this great job of maximizing the potential of the current technology without really any innovations. Electricity is a big innovation. You know, as we mentioned in a previous episode, Dennin, you like this time period because it's, you know, it's kind of an energy revolution. We're changing how we're doing things. But let's say we didn't and we kept steam, we kept gears. What's the best we could do? And this is very similar, you know, in our Archive 81 episode, we talked about the PXL camera, which could take video recordings on an audio tape, which is maximizing the format. I love that. And I think that that's really what steampunk does. And that's why it resonated with me, why I was attracted to this genre. But let's talk about steam. You know, we got to talk about boilers, you know, the steam power components. So first of all, let's talk about the physics. How does steam work? Like what is the physical stuff that's going on? And then how do we harness that to get it to do anything for us?
Well, I think it's really kind of two cool ideas, right? Normally, before you had this breakthrough in understanding thermodynamics, steam, heat, and the connection to work, we knew that if you kind of did work, you often generated waste heat. I mean, just think about it. Every time you work out, what happens? Your body gets hotter and you sweat, right?
Like, that's sure. It definitely gets hotter, Dennin.
Yes, that's the epitome.
That's the goal, right? Yeah.
Right? That's the epitome of thermodynamics in all senses of the word.
Exactly.
now, what the breakthrough was realizing this deep connection between heat and work and the fact that you could take heat, you know, and use it to do useful work, usually by expanding a gas or pressurizing a gas and then sending it through something at high speeds. Mm-hmm. And so that is kind of the general idea. If you take a gas in an enclosed space and it expands, it's going to move a piston, and that piston, that motion can now be used to do work. So the basic physics is very straightforward. Combine it, put a cool gas, or, you know, start with water, because then you can get from water to steam to even higher pressures, and make the gas expand, move the piston, and then drive some other motion. And then you use all the gears and stuff to translate into the different things. So the physics is also really cool because that steam, basic steam engine is really the foundation of setting the limits of the efficiency of everything and any motor you might build. So when you study physics, all you really do is talk about the Carnot cycle, this cool basic fundamental engine that is actually depressingly tells you the limits of your efficiency. No matter what you can do, you can only get so efficient and never make your You can never make your perpetual motion machine. I had to say that slowly because otherwise I'd be moving too quickly.
Now, Dennin, you know, someday
your mouth is in perpetual motion there, I think. But yeah,
you know, Dennin, first of all, correction: it's a hot idea, not a cool idea. But
got to be accurate.
I also think, you know, someday we're gonna find that infinitely cold heat sink. And, you know, we're going to get that 100% Carnot engine. Someday, Dennin, I believe we're going to find a way.
See, that's the difference here. You know, right. I have to tell a short personal story. Two gentlemen actually came many, many years ago to pitch their perpetual infinite source of energy machine to me. And
love this story.
And I was unfortunately honest. They were willing to pay me to, you know, sort of evaluate their system. And I just said, look, I know the second law of thermodynamics, so I know it doesn't work. And they said, but look, where does it fail? It makes a lot of sense. And I said, I don't know where it fails because you've explained something in a very complicated way that I can't understand. I just know it fails, and that's physics.
Now, Dan, they could have been hiding an infinite heat sink somewhere.
They could have. Oddly, they were using sand from the bottom of the ocean, so I don't think they were trying to hide any heat sinks.
Huh. Well, I can tell you, you know, personal story. My first story of the unexplained, how I got introduced to that whole world, was a story about a perpetual motion machine, which, you know, obviously the story is apocryphal because it wasn't created. It's not possible. But I imagine, you know, it's got to be possible in some way, shape, or form. But that's not the purpose of this episode. So when we've got steam, we know we're not going to get a perpetual motion machine. What do we create? What does a steam engine look like? And how can we utilize it to power stuff, Ben?
Yeah. So steam engines have a few basic parts. There's the heat source, which, you know, let's use the old timey steam locomotive as an example, because I think we've all seen that. Mm-hmm. So you have a firebox in the steam locomotive that is usually powered with wood or coal or oil, and that burns water. Or burns water. It burns
that's
that fuel.
Amazing.
Whoa. Yeah. It burns that fuel, which heats the water in the boiler. So that firebox will be surrounded with water to keep it cool. And also then that exhaust will usually then go through pipes through the tank of water. And that will boil the water. The water then gets collected into a steam collector at the top. You usually see these like kind of little bubbles on the top of the locomotive. Those are where the steam gets collected. And then you open valves and drive those pistons, which we talked about earlier. And then those pistons convert that motion of the piston's linear motion. Which
I can't tell if you're pitching a perpetual motion machine here. It got very complex, Ben.
This is very complex.
By the way, I think this whole topic has too many of the letter P's in it. None of us can pronounce our P's correctly. I think that's the only problem we're having here, Dan.
Yeah, the microphones are not loving it, but yeah, go on.
So the piston moves back and forth from the pressure of the steam, which moves that arm, which drives the wheel, and that's how the locomotive moves.
And so how can we... So, in a locomotive, you know, we know we're using it to turn wheels and move it forward. But I know, you know, the Industrial Revolution was based on the steam engine. You had a, you know, big boiler in these places, and you had all of these belts going to different rooms. You know, that was kind of like the mechanical equivalent of a power outlet. You know, what was that doing? What were we able to use it to do, the work that Dennin's talking about?
Well, I think just real quickly from the physics here, Dan, I'll say before Ben tells us how to actually build it, you know, the key trick in all of life was changing linear motion into circular motion or vice versa, right? Mm-hmm. So we have in my house an old-timey, I like, you know, Ben's phrase of that, I'll call it old-timey, sewing machine, right, that you don't actually plug into the wall. It has a pedal with a belt, and you would sit there and you'd pedal your feet up and down, and that would rotate this wheel. And then the rotation would be turned to linear motion. And the sewing machine, you know, the little needle would go up and down like we all know. Right. And now you're sewing sort of by, you know, at a higher speed and more power because you've generated it through your legs and belts and gears instead of just your hand and a needle, right? And what the steam engine does fundamentally is simply replace people power with steam power. So everything we had sort of figured out up to that point, whether it was a weaving machine, a sewing machine, you know, other types of assembly that we could do, is all basically either moving things up and down or moving things in a circle. And you then just attach that to a steam engine using a clever engineer to figure out how to make those gears work. And that is my segue to our clever engineer.
Yeah. Yeah. So when you look at the old-timey locomotive, it's pretty clear what happens. You have the piston moving back and forth, which drives the wheels in rotationally, and the train moves. That's pretty simple. But, you know, steam engines were used for a lot more than that. Factories were run off of steam engines. So in Dennin's example of the sewing machine, there would be tailoring factories where everybody's sewing machine was hooked up with belts to a big overhead shaft that went through the whole machine. You know, they'd have these big belts, often made out of leather, that they could kind of clutch in and out off of their machine. And you'd have one big steam engine, you know, at the end of the factory driving this whole apparatus. Hmm. And that is how you would get this rotational motion of the steam engine to everybody's individual workstations.
Wow. I mean, it seems, when you talk about big, it seems gigantic. I mean, these boilers and the whole mechanical process just seems so huge. And it makes me think, you know, when it comes to steampunk, one of the cool things is you have a lot of, you know, robots, you've got cars, you got, you know, all kinds of stuff that are powered by steam. But, you know, when we look at now, we've got internal combustion engines, and they can be very, very small, you know, and still run a car. But these steam engines had to be huge. Miniaturization has allowed technology to advance, and I feel like kind of one of the downsides, besides the danger of steam, which we're going to get to in a second, the downside is how do you miniaturize it? It's got to be, even the smallest things are still pretty large, I'm guessing.
Oh, I think that's so true. You know, the smallest scale is a very large scale for the steam engines. And I think there's really two problems there. One is just to generate the power you want, right? If you think about what's going on, this is an engine, you're using it to generate power. When we think about a lot of our miniaturization, the key is electronics is what we're miniaturizing. And there, you know, ironically, the power demands are not usually the limit in that case, right? Because you're the way we use electricity. But, you know, in the steam engine, you need a big engine to make the power you want. And you need the heat source, and it's really hard to shrink a heat source. So, you know, it's really fun because in the modern, it's really, yeah, it just is, right? Yeah. You know, in the modern world, of course, scientists always like to make things either super small or super big. And so there are scientists who, for fun, make really teeny steam engines with using lasers and other pieces. And they fully admit it has no practical value whatsoever. There's nothing you can do with it. Yeah. They're just trying to understand the physics of the whole cycle of the engine, right? And make something really small and see what you can do. So if all you care about is knowledge, Dan, you can sort of make a steam engine small. If you want it to be useful, you're stuck with something big, which really, you know, is an interesting question of then what does life look like? That's why I kind of loved your question of, okay, we don't get electricity, we don't get miniaturization. You know, what are you really doing with your steam engines and how small are they? I mean, they played with things. Ben, I think you heard about a bike that probably wasn't very small, even though we think of bikes as small, right?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. So people did make miniature steam engines back in the day. But, you know, and there are people who made steam powered bicycles, you know, with our not the old timey giant wheel, mini wheel bikes, but, you know, bikes that look like the bikes we have today. They just have a giant, you know, a steam engine the size of a couple 2-liter bottles on the front wheel to move the thing.
So it's like a moped, so like a stoped kind of, like a steam-powered ped. I don't know.
It's a steam motor, I guess. So it could still be a moped.
Right,
But what's interesting about it is it does work, but when you get to these smaller and smaller things, you're losing the economy of scale of the steam engine. And now you have this tiny steam engine that's only bike powered. It's only good for one person. And so now you, the bike rider, has to worry about, is there enough water in there? Is the fuel running out? All this stuff. And, you know, it's a lot easier at a factory when you have a big steam engine, because then you have a person whose job it is to make sure the steam engine's working, and everybody else who's running their sewing machines or running their table saws or, you know, whatever this factory is doing, you know, they can focus on their work while your one steam engine tender does the job of dealing with the steam engine.
Was that their name, the steam engine tender? Was that?
Well, actually, it's probably the engineer.
Engineer, I'm thinking, yeah. I like steam engine tender. I think that I do like that. And I would, you know, these are spoilers. We just really quickly, they're pretty dangerous if not operated correctly or maintained. I don't know that I want one on my ped. If I don't want a stow ped, is what I'm saying, because I'm pretty sure it's going to blow up.
Yeah.
Well, that just puts you in Wile E. Coyote country there, Dan, right? Like, either if you're the coyote, it blows up. If you're the roadrunner, you're fine.
Right. Well, if you're the roadrunner, it somehow survives the overpressure and makes you go super fast without any danger.
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, and that is one of the crazy things about both Wile E. Coyote and steam power. So quickly, why is it, Ben, I know you know why it's so dangerous. So this is kind of where in a lot of the steampunk stuff, you have to really take into consideration how dangerous it is and how big it is. So quickly, why is it so dangerous?
Well, pressure vessels are inherently dangerous. That, you know, even in the modern world, you know, with OSHA, you know, that follows safety practices in factories, the things they look out for the most are pressurized tanks and things like that not being secured. And a steam boiler is simply a high pressure vessel. But in this case, back in the day, it's not made out of modern alloys. It's made out of you know, wrought iron or maybe some old steel, you know, not modern steel. And if it gets overheated, the steel can creep and start bulging and explode. And that often comes from just simple things like it running out of water. If you run out of water, the metal will heat up too much and it'll explode because it loses strength. Or, you know, you have these stories of engineers who were, you know, behind schedule on their train. So they, you know, they crank the safety valve down a little bit so that they can get some more, or up, I guess, up so they can get a higher pressure because they'll go faster with the higher pressure. But then the steam engine isn't designed for that high pressure and it blows up, you know, so this pursuit of staying on schedule ends up with a blown up engine and you don't make your schedule at all.
It just goes to prove, you know, the tortoise and the hare story remains true even for a steam engine. slow and steady wins the race. Fast blows you up.
Right.
Yeah.
I think that was the message in the tortoise and hare original Aesop fable. I believe the hare blew up.
I think that's exactly how it went.
Yeah.
Too far.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. That's how I remember it.
Yeah. The hare overrode its safety valve and blew up.
Exploded right before the finish line. That's the story I was told as a kid. I don't know what anyone else heard. So you got this dangerous thing. You know, you talked about it being on a motorcycle, you know, the Stanley Steamer, which has a different meaning now. But back then it was a car that was driven by steam power. So they had cars that were driven by steam. But, you know, when you're talking about steampunk, one of the cool modes of conveyance is the dirigible, the airship, right? And this is, you know, it kind of had the, you know, we have the Goodyear blimp now, but I think the airship heyday was really in the, you know, the late 1800s, early 1900s, basically up until the Hindenburg, I think, is when people liked airships. But, you know, there weren't a lot of lift vehicles. You know, the Wright brothers were still before this time, and they had lift vehicles, but you know, we didn't really have those. So what is it about flying Zeppelins as a staple? Could we have gone that way instead? I mean, what are the physics behind it? So there are other ways to get a ship up safely besides using hydrogen and, you know, exploding a million people in the air?
Well, first of all, Dan, I wish we had gone with the name lift vehicles, not airplanes. Imagine, you know, if we were just flying today, I'm going to the lift port to take my lift vehicle.
I mean, an elevator is a lift in England. So, I mean, it's.
No, you know, yeah, it's, exactly. I'm going to start a petition online to rename airplanes lift vehicles. But, you know, one of the things that's interesting to me about it, right, is some of the trade-offs here. You know, you mentioned the hydrogen exploding, and hydrogen is flammable and you do have to take care and such. But airplanes carry a lot of stuff on them that can explode. And you know, we figured out safety mechanisms around it. And I think if we had never made the transition to lift vehicles or airplanes, you know, we would have probably figured out a lot of these safety issues. I think the fascinating idea, right, is your lift independent of your thrust, right? So basically that's what we went with the, you know, dirigibles and, you know, whether it's hot air balloons or hydrogen based or, you know, airships. And then the airplane's idea was you just take advantage of the thrust to generate lift. And they are interesting in that I wonder how much, you know, we mentioned we're imagining a world with a lot of electronics. Mm-hmm. And it really strikes me, I had never thought about it until we discussed this episode, how much electronics allows you to reduce the fundamental weight on your airplane so that you can get thrust that generates enough lift. Right. And so without electronics, you're stuck with the dirigible, and you do have to figure out, I think, these other safety issues. So from a physics point of view, I don't think a steam-powered non-electric world really ever gets you functional airplanes like we have now, just because of that scale issue, the weight issue, and the sizing of things.
Yeah. The big problem with steam engines is that you need a big tank of water to keep them working. And water's heavy. Water is really heavy. And so to have an airplane that can fly off of a steam engine is very problematic. And so you do need the lift coming from another source, like the helium blimp or the hydrogen airship, because that's, you take out, you get that lift kind of for free. You know, you don't have to worry, you you don't have to worry about it in terms of, do I have enough thrust to go over the wings? You can just keep making your balloon bigger to some degree to deal with how big your steam engine has to be.
I mean, I guess that makes sense. So you're saying you could get a steam engine into the air with a large enough balloon?
Yes.
Yeah. And then what you get to do, Dan, so then you can have the steam engine to make your thrust, your forward motion, if you really want. You know, or you can have a whole bunch of people cranking a propeller, right? You can go with the human. and I think you're actually, the water is heavy. I think the steam engine will work better than extra people cranking the propeller.
Yeah, the concern is actually, can you make a steam engine that's powerful enough to overcome the wind effect on your enormous balloon to lift your steam engine? And so, you know, you may kind of be stuck with your steam engine just, you know, being there to drive your refrigerator for your drinks, and you let the wind take you where it's going.
So it's like a sailboat in the sky.
Exactly. Well, and actually, I mean, I think that's a big steampunk theme, Dan, right? Is where the airships are more like sailboats, and the balloon is really just giving you the lift, and you really are trying to use the winds and sail the skies instead of sail the seas. And I think what that basic physics overlooks is how much a sailboat actually leverages the water. When you are flying in different directions, you actually get a lot of force and thrust by the way the water passes across you, not just the wind. There's some interesting physics in the sailboats, and the water is denser than the air. So it's a six and one half dozen the other. But I think you're really in steampunk. That's what I always thought was cool, is these flying ships that are really made to look like sailing ships of the 1800s, but just with a big balloon holding them up in the air.
The interesting thing is the hot air balloon is the sailing ship, right? If you ride a hot air balloon today, there's no propellers on it. You just go up and the wind takes you where it takes you. So, you know, there's this interesting idea. Could you make a balloon, like an airship shaped balloon, that has enough of that sideways air resistance such that sails on top of it could actually be used to get the same effect that you have in the water, where the water keeps you pointed in the direction you're going and the sails provide that thrust even if the wind isn't pointed in the direction you want to go?
I mean, I love that. I think we would have gotten there, you know, had the Wright brothers not come along. I mean, damn, the Wright brothers, if they had, we'd be flying around in airships. You know, but one of the things that I've got to stick in here, you know, you talked about pressurized boilers being very dangerous. You know, anyone who's played a zombie video game knows if you shoot a gas tank filled with pressurized gas, it's going to explode and take out a bunch of those zombies. So where am I going with this? What about a steam rocket? I mean, if you pressurize enough steam, couldn't you use that to propel yourself forward? I know we're not getting to the moon on steam rockets, but I feel like there's a way to do that. And we have a rocket engineer here, so it's a perfect question to ask you.
Yeah. So steam rockets were a subject of a lot of interest back in the day. And I've played not with steam rockets, but water rockets, where you have, you know, you can take a 2-liter soda bottle. This is, you know, kind of a classic science fair project where you take a soda bottle, you put some water in it, you pump it up with a bike pump, you know, maybe put some fins on it. And when you let it go, it'll fly because the high pressure air pushes the water out. That water is your source of reaction weight, and that will make your rocket fly. And you can do the same thing with steam. Instead of pressurizing that rocket with pressurized air, if you boil the water in the rocket and then have a relief valve at the bottom, that'll propel your rocket the exact same way, potentially with more energy because you can theoretically get to a higher pressure, and the water will kind of boil as it's going, giving you more energy. But it's, again, it gets back to that danger situation. You know, you're boiling water in a closed vessel without any relief valve. You know, if it can blow up and blow up all your rockets in your cool little rocket launching pad.
Well, I will just say, you know, safety is a key concern of many people, but apparently not me when I teach physics. Mm-hmm. So we have a classic demo we do in physics that's the cold version of the steam rocket. It's called the liquid nitrogen cannon. And so what you do, liquid nitrogen just naturally boils at room temperature. So you don't need a heat source. So you have a big metal tube that's mounted on wheels, hence the cannon. You fill it with liquid nitrogen, and then you like basically tap a water bottle into the front end to plug it up. You close your release valve and the liquid nitrogen boils, creating liquid nitrogen steam. The pressure builds up and eventually the thing launches out the end. And, you know, it's very exciting and the students all cheer. If you're really clever, you can overfill the thing with liquid nitrogen and freeze the water in your plastic bottle that's your cannonball. And so what happens is when it bursts out the end, the plastic cracks. The water sprays everywhere, and you get a lot of extra steam, and you get the front row of your class or audience wet, which has led to the classic in Dennin's physics lab. It's like SeaWorld. Those who sit in the front two rows may get wet, so be careful.
Well, and I imagine, you know, I grew up in the country. I got to stick in a story here as well, since we've all got projectile, gas-powered projectile stories. When I was a kid, I remember seeing a potato cannon for the first time. And I don't know if you guys, I'm sure you guys know what that is.
Oh, yeah.
Those who are listening. So it's a, it was a big long, it's just really well made. It's a big log PVC pipe, had a chamber, and so you would take hairspray and you'd spray it in the chamber, you'd close it, and then you'd stuff a potato in the you know, the gun end. It's like a musket, really. You plug it in, and, you know, put in your own ball bearings. And then it had a little twisty flintlock on it. I guess it's a flintlock. I don't know what it is, but it would cause a spark. It would ignite the hairspray, and the potato would launch. It was the coolest thing I ever saw as a kid. So imagine
it's the same. Steam, Dad. That's more explosive, but, you know, it's the same basic principle.
Right. No, I know it's not steam, but it's like an internal combustion engine. And those are outlawed in the steampunk genre. But I don't know. I love that idea of launching.
You could do the potato cannon with steam. You could boil water in there instead of, you know, burning hairspray. And then you get a cooked potato at the end.
Launched over to your neighbor's house.
Yeah.
It all works out. You get
instant mashed potatoes on what it hits.
Yeah. And you could put I wonder if you could put a grate in the front and make French fries, but I'm probably getting ahead of myself there.
Dan, we've just solved a cool steampunk technology, the French fryer.
I did it with hairspray. Get that nice little Aquanet hint to Aquanet on the way out. But, you know, we talked about gear-based technologies, right? You know how I love it. I named the show after gear-based technologies. We can't get out of the steampunk genre without talking about the mechanized computers. I've mentioned a few times about my admiration for the Antikytheria mechanism. This was the ultimate in gear-based technologies, this ancient Greek device that could tell you where all the constellations were going to be for hundreds of years into the future. This is, you know, I even think pocket watches are really cool. But, you know, you get to, when we're talking about steampunk, how do we make this advanced? You got Charles Babbage's Analytical Engine. Now, obviously, I love the name Analytical Engine. That was what I was going to call myself before I settled on the Analytical Mastermind. But this is, you know, it's a punch card based computer. And its purpose, I love this. I want to read this before I move on. It was a special purpose machine designed to tabulate logarithms and trigonometric theorems, trigonometric functions by evaluating finite differences to create approximating polynomials. I don't know what that means. It sounds pretty cool, but how can we turn that device into, complex computing and then ultimately into automatons, which for the steampunk era robots? That's a question. I'm going to go to you first, Dennin. Where are we going with this?
Look, all it is you start with your basic abacus, which hopefully, I don't know if kids get to play with in school, but it's that really cool fundamental computer where you can practice adding real quickly using beads and moving them up and down on little wires, right? Because you're just keeping track of where things are. You move from there to doing everything in binary. Everyone's favorite ones and zeros, because it's just easier to make things that are either on or off. And we think about it, you know, we think there's something magical about computers because they're all electronic and they're small, but they really are just things that can either be on or off and change their on and offness in sort of through logic gates and logical ways. And you can do this electronically, but it's almost easier to do it mechanically. It's just harder to make the mechanical things small. Right. Okay. So the step from Babbage's machine to do these calculations you talked about to actually what we think of as a modern computer with computer programming is intellectually or sort of abstractly not that hard. It just ends up being huge because it's the number of sort of transistors and other, you know, sort of electrical elements you have on your circuit board that make the computer powerful, not the sort of basic structure. So this is where our the smallest you can get is incredibly large problem really comes in more than anything else. But I love me a mechanical computer. So I'm with you, Dan. This is just awesome.
Well, what's interesting though is you mentioned binary, which is how our modern electronic computers work. But a lot of these old mechanical computers didn't even work, didn't even need binary. You can make the gear represent, you know, 0 to 9 and do math in numbers we understand intuitively, which is a really fascinating benefit of these machines and something that is kind of lost in modern computer science, where, you know, not everybody just can think in binary. It's a very different representation of numbers. And because for whatever reason we chose base 10 as our society,
we have 10 fingers system. Ben, remember that we have 10
fingers. It's because we have 10
fingers.
It's
not for whatever reason, it's for our 10 fingers.
Fair enough, Dan.
Most of us have 10 fingers. Some people who operate steam engines may not have all of them.
If only we had 16 fingers, computers and people would be in the same numbering system. But unfortunately, that's not the case.
Well, I mean, it raises an interesting question because, you know, Dennin, you're talking about the scaling's difficult. But, you know, mechanical punch cards, I don't want to sell these things short. I'm with you, Ben. They can do some pretty amazing things, including sending our astronauts to the moon. It was a punch card computer that calculated our trip to the moon. So these can be very powerful. Now, I know that was augmented a little bit by electricity before anyone comes after me for that, but it was still basically punch powered. We do have a lot of P's in this episode, Dennin. But I think this is really amazing because it was going on then, but the next step up that we have to go to is we have these punch powered computers. How do we turn it into an automaton? Another great thing, steampunk, are these automated, these robot figures that are, you know, gear-based robots. I love the orchestrons. These are musical devices. Here in Los Angeles, there's a great museum called the Nethercut, and in it they have these gigantic wooden cabinets with a full orchestra. I mean, a complete orchestra in them, and kind of like, you know, a much more elegant and beefed up player piano, you could stick in a punch card equivalent, and it would... You know, you got an orchestra, you got a 10-piece orchestra playing music in this gigantic cabinet, all through gear-based technology, all through analytical engines. There's something here, and I think had electricity not come along, I think we'd be walking around with mechanized robots. What do you guys think?
Well, you know, Dan, I really think so, except for one twist. This is actually, in my mind, best done pre-steampunk, right? This is a case where I would rather base these on the sort of analog equivalent of the battery, which is the spring storage device. So the steampunk is the energy source, and we generally do it by rotating things. Most of these automaton and these other devices are simply done by hand cranking to tighten a spring, which then is equivalent of your battery. The spring is storing the energy, and then it slowly releases it, right?
Right.
And what's fascinating to me is in modern, right now, in our source for clean energy, one of the biggest barriers is the battery technology, right? Because you really, really need amazing storage mechanisms for electricity if you're going to really achieve the clean energy you want. Because the solar and the wind are the cleanest, but you don't get them all the time. So you need some way to get electricity when they're not working. And I think the spring becomes the battery of steampunk. The spring is your fundamental energy storage device in a steampunk world. And you would have seen great advances in material science around making better springs that can store energy for longer, so your automaton or your orchestra will work longer. Whereas now we're trying to get batteries to store our electricity for longer. And so this was, I just think this is the coolest sort of physics material science moment of our steampunk without electricity world.
I think that's a great point, Dennin, because one of my favorite movies of one of the favorite movies of my youth is one we don't talk about a lot, and most society doesn't talk about a lot, and that's Return to Oz. I love this movie. It's not, we can't do it as an episode because I don't think there's enough in it, but it includes a woman taking off her head, and I don't think we have the technology to keep heads alive inside of a gigantic cabinet. It's definitely not your mom's Wizard of Oz. Return to Oz is not. But the one thing they have in this movie is a robot named TikTok, and he's so cool because he's this gigantic copper steampunk robot, and he's got three turn cranks in the back, keys or whatever you call them, and you twist them, and one's for speech, one's for movement, and one's for brain activity, right? Like one's for the brain. And this is great because it's doing what you're talking about, Dennin. It's power, using springs to power up the steampunk robot. And then what's great is there's great comedic moments where, you know, the brain runs out while the mouth is still moving. And, you know, he sounds a lot like me most of the time, right? With brain shut off. But it's, you know, it's a great idea. And I think you're right, Dennin. This is the way to do it. Ben, would we have gone in this direction? Is this what would have happened if we had, you know, if Edison, Tesla had never come along and electricity would have been a thing of the future?
Well, even if Edison and Tesla had come along, but we never figured out batteries for some reason, I think this would have been the future. Because the storage of energy in springs is a pretty good way to store energy. It's not necessarily very efficient, but you know, if you don't have anything better, that's kind of what you're left with. And so I wasn't ready for this. I wasn't ready for Dennin to bring in this. Springs are the batteries of steampunk, because I just hadn't thought of it. But I do think we would have come up with different geometries for these springs, different materials to use, so that they would be. That you would stay out of the plastic region of deformation, so that the spring would not deform at all and continue working. There'd be a very interesting metallurgy around how to make better and better springs.
Well, I think that the plastic area of deformation is a place I don't ever want to go. I don't know about you guys, but it's a very dangerous place. Don't ever step foot there.
Well, this is the problem with Plastic Man versus Elastic Man, but that's a whole different episode.
That's a whole different show, Dennin. That's a whole different show. I do love that you broke our resident a battery-powered robot with the thought that he could be powered by springs. I think that's put into his programming. He's not allowed to compute that. But if there's anything that we've missed, this is the place we're going to talk about it. This is our errors, additions, and omissions section. This is things that we didn't quite get to, but we still want to talk a little bit about. I'm going to put that in there. Dennin, do you have anything about steampunk that we didn't quite get to you wanted to cover?
Well, I just, you know, I really like the look of steampunk. Mm. And I do wonder, you know, steampunk often has goggles, right? We talked about cosplay. There's a lot of goggles in steampunk. And it just makes me wonder, did they really think that's what's going to protect them from the explosion of the boiler? I mean, I assume that's what the goggles are for. Because obviously, you know, you don't want your goggles fogging up or steaming up. There's a lot of steam around. So the goggles, you know, are problematic from that perspective. The goggle thing looks cool. Don't get me wrong. I like the look, but I don't understand it. It's the one piece, you know, like I say, but let's face it, you know, I'm a practicing physicist at a university. We care about safety all the time. You can't be in your lab without goggles. Even if they're not going to protect you from the exploding boiler. So the goggles, you know, the goggles are the element here that I'm trying to figure out their use. I understand the physics of goggles. I want to be clear about that. It's not the physics that's confusing me. It's actually what, is it just a style?
Right.
Or is it just practical?
I think it's a style. I do think even I understand the physics of goggles. I'm not 100% sure, but I think I understand most of it. So I guarantee you understand it, Dennin. This is not a comprehension issue. I think it's an aesthetic issue. I think you're right, but I like them as well.
What about you? Make me wonder, Dan, on your fascinating noun episodes, because I love the ones on fashion. Yeah. Have you interviewed a fashion expert on goggles, or was it just ties and shirts and collars?
Well, we talked about the Victorian era, but because steam wasn't powering everything back then, I mean, we didn't talk about goggles. I might have to revisit it and discuss why copper goggles are used. I love them because, you know, my favorite characters in all these fantasy worlds are tinkerers, and everything's always exploding. They're always running around with explosives, you know. But why prospectors didn't have them, I'll never understand. They're always running around with nitroglycerin. And why not face masks? Well, we could talk about goggles forever, Dennin. I don't know why they didn't even have face masks. But what about you, Ben? Did goggles bother you this much? Was there anything else you wanted to talk about that we didn't
get to? No, I think it's important to think about goggles because in the steampunk world, you know, you have the risk of things exploding all the time, and that eye protection is important. And, you know, a face shield would definitely be better, but, you know, in the absence of, you know, face shields, yeah, wear those goggles. Another thing to remember is, you know, especially in a world where it's coal-based, you know, you're going to have a lot of soot, and a lot of that stuff is kind of acidic, and you don't want it getting into your eyes. It'll sting. Oh. And so having those goggles will also protect your eyes from the kind of crummy atmosphere that's going to be around in this steampunk world.
Well, not your lungs. It won't protect your lungs, but it will protect your eyes.
Yeah, you should probably have a mask too.
Right. Well, speaking of explosions, when I thought, you know, I watched Wild Wild West, one of my favorite parts of that movie was there's this old general who must have had his ear blown off, and they've attached like a little horn, like on the old phonographs, right to his ear. I thought that was a great use of a prosthetic. I wish they would have kind of done more with that. I thought that was really cool. But is there anything about steampunk that you think that we missed that you want to tell us about? You can get in touch with the show. We're on social media, easy to get a hold of. You can find the show on Twitter at FGGGbTpod. We're on Facebook at FGGGbT. But of course, you can get in touch with us individually. Dennin, where can people find you?
Well, you can find me on Twitter and Instagram. Just flip my name. It's at Dennin Michael. And then on Facebook, I'm at Prof Dennin Michael.
Ben, where can people find you?
You can find me on all the major social media networks at B Siepser.
How do you spell that?
Spell that B-S-I-E-P-S-E-R.
And I can be found on Twitter at Daniel J. Glenn, on Instagram at The Daniel J. Glenn, and on Facebook at Analytical Mastermind. And if you have any questions you want us to answer, you can contact the show via steampunk era technology, i.e. email, and that is questions at fggbt.com.
And as you listen to us on your favorite podcast platform, make sure you rate and review and double check that you're subscribed.
And if you're watching us on YouTube, hit the like button, subscribe, and ring the bell so you never miss an episode, and you help us out with that algorithm.
And finally, this show contains powerful scientific information that can be misused by those hell-bent on world domination or time alteration, to be perfectly honest. Now remember, before you make your decision, you want to try to be a superhero, not a supervillain. So until next time, thank you for listening.